There is comfort in the words of Isaiah the prophet today. Comfort, give comfort to my people, says your God. Isaiah, as we know, was writing to a people, God's people, who have lost everything they valued more than anything else, everything that would give meaning to the appellation people of God. No temple, no land, no permanent abode that they could call their own. Isaiah, speaking in God's name, was giving comfort to a people who were far from comfortable and at ease in a land that was not theirs. Sans place of worship, sans country, sans political power, sans everything. He spoke to a people whose suffering was non pare, if you will, sans rival. Isaiah prophesied to a people who could hardly be said to be at peace. What type of peace is there for one who has been violently uprooted from one's homeland? What sort of peace does one enjoy far from the typical scenes of one's birthplace, away from familiar smells and sounds, distant from one's family and community rituals and practices that are associated with personal and communal identity and security? What peace is there to speak of for one whose family members are scattered all over against one's choice and expressed will? And yet today, Isaiah, Peter, John the Baptist, the Lord Jesus Christ himself, they all speak words of comfort, words of solace and promise. They all point to realities beyond anyone's dreams. Isaiah speaks of every valley going to be filled in, rugged land being made plain, every mountain and hill being made low. The psalmist, for his part, confidently pursues and requests the kindness and salvation from the Lord as confidently as he declares, "Kindness and truth shall meet, justice and peace shall kiss." Peter points to the much-awaited new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. And the third reading speaks with an air of definitiveness about the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Are these not part two of what we as Filipinos also long for here and now? Isn't this comfort and the patent lack of it for a great many of our people what we so need to hear and appropriate in our own lives? Isn't the gift of peace a fruit of justice, something we all long for, pine for, and even fight for? Don't we at some time or other dream of a better country, a more prosperous nation, a more united people, better leadership? Have we not prayed to be spared from all the ruggedness of the valleys, mountains, and hills that seem to characterize the trajectory of our common history as a people? Our response to today's promise could not have been better phrased. Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation. Let us see your kindness, Lord. What type of peace is there for us when we are consistently in the top 15 list of most corrupt countries? What type of a new earth can we hope for when Manila is right now considered the pollution capital of the world, with pollution levels judged to be 5 times more than acceptable international standards? What gospel, good news, is there to look forward to when all we hear are reports of scams and scandals and summary killings and intrigues of every sort coming from the highest offices of the land, not excluding our very own church pastors and leaders? Grant us your salvation, Lord. Yes, grant us salvation, but not the type that comes like magic from the heavens. Grant us salvation, Lord, the type of salvation that is a fruit of your work and ours, a salvation that should move us to strive to match a new earth with your promise of a new heavens. Grant us salvation, Lord. Make of us persons that we ought to be, conducting ourselves in holiness and devotion, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God. eager to be found without spot or blemish before Him at peace. Do grant us peace, O Lord, the peace that is a fruit of justice, justice that we do not only talk about. Do grant us peace, O Lord, a peace that comes from knowing we have done our part to prepare the way of the Lord and to make straight His paths in obedience to the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The Lord does proclaim peace, but it is up to us to do peace and cultivate peace. The Lord brings good news, but it is up to you and me to live it. The Lord gives us all it takes to make a new earth out of this messy world of corruption and sin and murders and deaths and selfishness and sordid gain. The Lord has given us and still gives us, like today, His message and gift of peace and salvation. But there is work to do. We cannot simply sit and wait. We need to wait in active hope. We need to do our share. We need to wait, but as Peter says, we need to hasten at the same time the coming of the day of God. There surely is something that awaits our first move in our lives, at home, in our families, in our communities, at work, in relation to others. Someone has to make the first move of reconciliation. Someone has to budge a finger to solve the trash problem everywhere. Someone has to begin giving in a traffic snarl. It only takes a little humility. We cannot all be stonewalling all the time. Someone has to start giving others little, seemingly insignificant acts of courtesy. All it takes is for one to start acting civilly instead of always wanting to pull a fast one over others. Sometimes all we need is to start treating others nicely and politely, and everything turns out smoothly. Salvation is as much God's work as ours. Grace, which comes from God, is never wanting. What is lacking more often than not is our contribution, our response, our cooperation. We need to be the ones to do the filling in, the leveling, the smoothening out of the basically man-made creases and inequalities in our lives and in the world. I would like to share with you at this point a beautiful image of God, the Holy Spirit, working ever so gently and unobtrusively so that peace becomes a reality in the world. Despite our protestations and complaints, despite our initial disappointments, when will you ever peace, wild wood dove, shy wing shut, you're round me roaming in and under be my boughs, when peace, will you peace? I'll not play hypocrite to my own heart. I yield, you do come sometimes, but that piecemeal peace is poor peace. What pure peace allows alarms of war, the daunting wars, the death of it? Oh, surely, reaving peace, my Lord should leave in you some good. And so He does leave patience exquisite that blooms to peace thereafter. And when peace here does house, He comes with work to do. He does not come to coo. He comes to brood and sit. There are some things here that we ought to learn. The poem of Gerard Manley Hopkins that I just quoted captures our disappointment. When will peace finally prevail in the world? We do not want piecemeal peace. We do not want peace that still allows the possibility of conflict. But when the Lord does take away peace, He must leave something good in its stead. He leaves patience. He leaves hope and active waiting, the same hope that we keep alive in Advent. This patience, when nurtured, is what engenders peace later. And this is the clincher. When peace does come like a mother dove, peace has work to do. He does not just come to coo. He comes to brood and sit. When a mother dove broods and sits over her nest, new life comes about. New little doves arise. New life, new hope is created. Patience, patient waiting in hope. This is what Advent waiting is. is all about. Peace will come sooner or later, for the Lord has already proclaimed it. We claim it now as our own. How? By working for it in our own little way. It will come. It does come today, tomorrow, sooner or later, in God's own good time. And this, my dear friends, is your Kalakbay at Katoto in this week's episode. O puso sa puso, saying thank you, and God bless you all.